Students, can anyone tell me, am I audible? Can you see the slide?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Students, in the first unit of risk management and insurance, we majorly came to know the meaning of risk and uncertainty. And we understood the types of risk, then sources of risk. Then we even understood the methods of handling risk. Then we came to know about the exposure of financial assets, exposure of human assets, then exposure to legal liability, exposure to work-related injury. Well, today we will discuss the risk measurement techniques in Unit 2. See, we'll majorly understand. So first, let me tell you what all concepts are there in Unit 2. Then I'll take you in depth of this particular unit. So in Unit 2, we will be understanding risk measurement, then evaluating the frequency and severity of the losses, risk control. Then we'll even understand various techniques related to risk financing, then advanced issues in risk management, then forecasting financial analysis in risk management. And finally, we will try to understand the decision making or other risk management tools. Now, let me explain you that all of you know by this time that identification of risk plays a very, very important role for let it be any organization. But now risk measurement in Unit 2, we'll try to understand the risk measurement. See, after risk identification process, please see the slide over there. After risk identification process, the next step in the risk management process is to estimate both the frequency as well as the severity of potential losses. Someone wants to join. Students, am I audible? Can you see the slide?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay, okay. So after the first process, that is risk identification process, once a risk has been identified, the next step in the risk management process is to estimate both the frequency and the severity of the potential losses. So the risk manager, what he does, he obtains the information that is helpful in determining the relative importance of the identified risk and in selecting particular techniques for managing those risks. So the daily occurrence of some inventory breakage may be an expected part of some businesses, correct? And would warrant only minimal attention from the risk manager. So one complicating factor in evaluating the exposure is that many losses do not result in complete destruction of the asset involved. Now, evaluating the frequency and severity of the losses. See, when I say frequency and severity of the losses, that means an accident will happen how many times? That is frequency. How many times the same incident happens in an organization, or how many times the same type of losses happens when you take a position, and up to what extent the loss can happen. Correct? So evaluating the frequency and severity of losses means first we need to identify how many times in a month the same incident will be happening, and if the loss happens, up to what extent the loss might happen. So severity is the likely size of the loss. Correct? It is derived from the expected losses of the group likely to buy a policy. In order to see an impact on the risk profile of an insured population, it is necessary to see that micro insurance product is durable. So what is insurance? We use normally for covering the risk, that is insurance product. So insurance as a risk distribution tool, it is useful only if pursued for a long term. Correct? Too much activity with insured persons moving in and out will not only prevent impact on the risk profile of the community, but also make the product volatile. Thus, students, please understand, a sustainable micro insurance program presupposes the existence of an optimally priced product with the frequency as well as the severity factors carefully balanced. So if the risk covered do not naturally fall within the limits, what happens? They have to be manually adjusted through underwriting and marketing interventions. Now, can anyone tell me what is the meaning of underwriting when it comes to insurance? I'm asking specifically related to insurance, underwriting related to insurance. Anybody? You have already studied this concept. Whom do you call an underwriter related to insurance? See, insurance underwriting, let me explain all of you, please pay attention. It is the process of evaluating a company's risk in insuring a home or a car or automobile or an individual's health. So insurance underwriters, they establish pricing for accepted insurable risk. What do you mean by underwriting? The term underwriting means receiving remuneration for the willingness to pay a potential risk. So underwriters, normally what they do, they use specialized software and actual data to determine the likelihood and the magnitude of a risk. So when it comes to securities market, students, the underwriting involves determining the risk and price of a particular security. It is a process seen most commonly during when IPOs, correct? Wherein investment banks first buy or underwrite the securities of the issuing entity and they'll sell them in the market. So what do underwriters do there in case of initial public offering? So first what they do, they give a guarantee to the company which is coming up with an IPO that, see, we will purchase so many shares during the IPO. So underwriting involves determining the risk and price of a particular security, which is commonly seen during the initial public offerings, that is IPO process, wherein what happens, investment banks first buy or they underwrite the securities of the issuing company or the entity, and then they can sell in the market and make the profit from that. Whereas insurance underwriters, they analyze the risk in insurance proposals. Then they determine the policy terms and calculate the premiums on the basis of what? On the basis of actual or statistical and then background information. So please understand, students, majority of the insurance companies run graduate schemes that offer a route into underwriting. Then we'll try to understand why it is called underwriting. Because the process through which an individual or an institution takes on financial risk for a fee. So basically, students, the term underwriter originated from the practice of having each risk taker writing their name under the total amount of risk they are willing to accept for a specified premium. So there are various types of underwriting. The firm underwriting is there. That is when the firm undertaking underwriting is an underwriting agreement in which underwriter takes up a certain number of securities of the firm itself. So the underwriting process is so important in insurance? Yes, it is very important, right? Because it is the foundation of the whole insurance industry. Please understand this. Underwriting is the foundation of the whole insurance industry. That's why it's so important for underwriters to make the right decisions, but it is up to them and nobody else to ensure that the correct level of risk is entering the industry and that this risk is matched by the right premium. So basically, this underwriting commission is the compensation that an underwriter receives for placing a new issue with investors. So even if the company does not have to buy any shares, the fee is paid as a return for the implicit risk involved in the underwriting contract. So it is calculated as a discount from the price of the new issue. Okay, so this is just an introduction about this underwriting. Now we'll try to understand the techniques of estimating frequency and severity, which is very, very important. Explain the various techniques of estimating the frequency and severity. They might ask you, right? So what do you mean by, you understood now, estimating frequency and severity, right? Frequency means what? How many times an incident will happen, or how many times the accident might happen? And severity means if the loss happens, up to what extent, or up to how much severe is the loss? So there are basically four techniques to estimate the frequency and severity of losses. So some risk managers consider these concepts informally in evaluating identified risk. So they may broadly classify the frequency of various losses into categories such as, you know, they might say slight or moderate and certain, and may have a similarly broad estimates for loss severity. Correct? It is now very common to use the probability distributions and even sometimes statistical techniques in estimating both the loss frequency as well as the severity of the losses. Now, this is very important question, students. I'll explain each one in detail. The first one is called risk profiling, sometimes risk mapping. Second is called statistical concepts. The third one is called loss distributions in risk management. And finally, we have integrated risk measures. First, we'll try to understand risk profiling or risk mapping. So please understand now, a technique for profiling pure risk as a step towards analyzing the risk and prioritizing them is to map the risk in a matrix. So based on the severity and the frequency, what I'll do is I'll map the risk in a matrix. So why it is required? What is the purpose of this? The purpose of risk profiling is to identify those risks that seem to be most significant. That is, we can say greatest, so that the priority attention can be given more to them, where the frequency as well as the severity will be high. So the two sides of the matrix, they represent the frequency of adverse outcomes and then severity of the loss when an adverse outcome occurs. So, risk with a low likelihood of happening but a high impact are often suitable for containment through insurance. The risk measurement matrix is sometimes drawn as a 3x3 matrix. Okay, so basically in risk profiling or risk mapping, what we'll do is we'll prioritize the risk based on the frequency and the severity of the loss which is going to happen, and then start working on them. Suppose if I give out of 10 priority 10 for a particular process, that means the probability of the an accident which is going to happen and the severity of the losses will be very high for that particular process. Correct? So that is called risk profiling or even risk mapping. And the second technique of estimating the frequency and severity is statistical concepts. You have already studied this statistical concepts during your first and the second semester. So some essential concepts from the field of probability and statistics will be taken. So it can be probability, or it can be measures of central tendency, Or it can be a random variable. Or very simple is measures of variation. That means we basically use standard deviation. For example, a manufacturer's 100 employees who are injured during a year. Right, the loss from these injuries ranges from say 500 to 25,000 with an expected value of 12,500. So how do I say the range of the individual losses is rather great? Please understand, the range of the individual losses is rather great. From 500 to 25,000, the average injury is 12,500, which is not very descriptive of the magnitude of the average loss. How? Especially if one is comparing it with another group of 100 losses that range in severity from 11,000 to 14,000, but also have an average loss of 12,500. So in this case, it is helpful to state precisely just how the two groups differ. So by comparing the standard deviation of two sets of injuries, the precise variation in injuries becomes very clear. So how do we calculate it? First the standard deviation. First we have calculated variance. And then what we have done is standard deviation is equal to square root of variance, right? So to calculate the standard deviation of a group of measure, first we must determine the expected value, the mean, what we call mean or expected value. Then what we have done, each individual value is subtracted from the mean. We have even calculated the similar type of problem in investment management, right? And the resulting figure is squared. Then what happens? The squared differences are added together with the sum divided by the total number of measurements. The result is the mean of the squared deviation, which is known as variance. Then how we have calculated standard deviation? It is very simple. The square root of the variance is the standard deviation. So what we are studying now, we are trying to understand the various techniques of estimating frequency and severity. The second technique what we are discussing now is statistical concepts. Then we have skewness. What is skewness? Measures of central tendency, which give us an estimate of the representative value of a series. The measures of dispersion gives an indication of the extent to which the items cluster around or scatter away from the central value, and the skewness is a measure that refers to the extent of symmetry or asymmetry in a distribution. Then we have covariance and correlation. All of you know by this point, to compute the variance of a portfolio return, it is important to understand covariance and correlations, which measure the degree to which a pair of returns tend to move. What do you mean by covariance? A positive covariance or correlation between two returns means that two returns tend to move together. That means if security A is moving in one direction, security B also tend to move in the same direction, then what we say, security A and security B are positively correlated. Or in the other case, what happens, students? If security A moves in one direction and if security moves exactly opposite to security A direction, then we say what? They are negatively correlated. So a negative covariance or correlation means that the returns tend to move in the opposite direction. So the covariance is a measure of relatedness that depends on the unit of measurement. Then the third technique, please hear, the third technique, that is loss distributions used in risk management. We are distributing the loss. So probability distributions can be very, very useful tool for evaluating the expected frequency or the severity of the losses due to identified risk. So basically, students, in risk management, there are two types of probability distribution which are used normally. One is empirical and the other one is theoretical. So to form an empirical probability distribution, the risk manager, what he does, he actually observes the events that occur. So to create a theoretical probability distribution, a mathematical formula is used. So here it is assumed that events occur in a random fashion, meaning that the probability that any one event will occur is equal to the probability that any other event will occur, which you have already discussed. Which are there? There are basically three theoretical probability distribution used widely in the risk management. That is binomial distribution, then Poisson distribution, and normal distribution curve. Which is one of the more normal distribution is one of the most important continuous probability distribution used in the entire field of statistics, which is the normal distribution. So its graph, which is called as the normal curve, is a bell-shaped curve, right? That extends indefinitely in both the directions, coming closer and closer to the horizontal axis, horizontal in the sense x-axis, without ever reaching. And the last technique of estimating the frequency and the severity is integrated risk measures. See, the assessment of risk in an integrated risk framework requires additional quantification techniques. So two very popular approaches used will be VAR, that is called as value at risk, and risk adjusted return on capital, that is ROC. I'm repeating once again, value at risk and risk adjusted return on capital. Now, what do you understand by value at risk? Value at risk analysis has been used by normally students, by banks, to quantify the financial risk, but is increasingly being considered by other types of firms that wish to access all the types of risk in a coordinated framework. So VAR analysis constructs probability distributions of the risk alone and in various combinations to obtain estimates of the risk of loss at various probability levels. Then the second one, what I told you was risk adjusted return on capital, that is ROC. Which is another measure sometimes used in an enterprise-wide assessment of risk, which is risk-adjusted return on capital. So this approach, students, attempts to allocate the risk cost to many different activities of the firm, such as products, projects, loans. So as a result of ROC, I'm repeating, ROC means what? Risk adjusted return on capital. Managers are forced to consider risk levels in evaluating the probability of their decisions. So these are the popular four techniques of estimating the frequency and the severity. The first and the foremost what we discussed was what? Risk profiling. Also called risk mapping. Then we have statistical concepts, then loss distributions that are used in risk management, and last but not the least, that is integrated risk measure, that is wherein we have discussed about value at risk, that is VAR, as well as risk adjusted return on capital, that is ROC. Then before going to risk control, I'll try to explain you the expected losses and the standard deviation. So how they are actually related. See, the actuaries of the insurance companies apply probability and statistical analysis to a given loss situation. So given an infinite number of trials and no changes of the underlying condition, the probability of an event is the long run relative frequency of it, while the probability of some events can be determined without experimentation, the probability of others can be estimated through the analysis of past loss data. So I think all of you have heard of central tendency of a distribution, which is the mean or the expected value. So in insurance students, the expected value is the probable amount of money lost, the expected loss. So how do we found? It is found by multiplying each outcome by its probability of occurrence and summing finally, right? Now we'll try to understand control, that is risk control. So a major issue for risk managers is the decision about how much money to spend on the various forms of risk or loss control. I'm repeating now, one of the most challenging aspects for the manager will be the decision about how much money to be spent on the various forms of loss control or risk control. So normally students, the general rule is that to justify the expenditure, the expected gains from an investment in loss control should be at least, please understand, at least equal to the expected cost. So this comparison of cost and benefits, which is similar to the financial decision making used for other capital budgeting issues. However, students, the risk manager must have a clear understanding of all the costs and benefits associated with the particular form of loss control or risk control. So risk control is an organized, please understand, risk control is an organized and usually continuous effort to help to decrease the possibility of unforeseen losses and the impact of those that do occur. So I'm not saying that I can completely avoid, but I minimize the loss, right? So the risk control or the loss control can be applied to all the kinds of losses, such as the losses that are being caused by the fire or accident or natural calamity, or just about anything that causes unexpected harm, injuries or damage. So basically, when we speak about risk control, there are two types, which are loss prevention as well as loss reduction. First, we'll try to understand loss prevention. As the name only suggests, it refers to measures that reduce the frequency of a particular loss. Basically, what I'm trying to tell you is, I am preventing the loss. So loss prevention, as its name implies, focuses on preventing or stopping the loss from the happening. The foremost purpose of loss prevention is to preserve or protect the human life. So risk manager's first goal in a loss prevention program is to reduce or eliminate the chances of death or injury to the people. The first priority will be given to human life in case of loss prevention. So large businesses often employ loss control engineers to identify the sources of loss. Source of loss also is very important, right? Identification of the risk is very important, or injury, and to institute corrective actions. So here, students, please understand, some losses can be attributed to workplace hazards, such as poor layout of machines or lighting or ventilator, poor maintenance practices or insufficient computer security. Correct. So when we speak about loss prevention specifically related to you know, insurance sector, so insurance loss control is a form of risk management that reduces the potential for losses in an insurance policy. So insurance companies may require policyholders to complete the loss control programs to cut down on risk and reduce the chances of claims. Whereas loss prevention or the risk prevention or risk control can benefit both the policyholders as well as insurers. Then we will try to understand the second type of risk control, that is loss reduction. That means reducing the severity of the loss, basically. So risk reduction involves methods that reduce the severity of the loss or the likelihood of the loss from occurring. Correct? In this method, the business reduces risk by taking appropriate steps for prevention of business risk or avoiding the loss. So such steps include adoption of safety programs. That those are very important, right? Safety programs. You need to educate your people who are working on the floor over there. You need to educate the people who are working in some projects, or installation of burglar alarm and extinguisher, employment of night security guard, arranging for medical care and disposal of waste material, or carefully training your employees in order to reduce the loss during the working environment. So these are the two types of risk control or the loss control methods. Now, what are the benefits of loss control? So there are many benefits associated with the risk control, which are either readily quantifiable or can be reasonably estimated. Students, some of the benefits include, repair or replacement of damaged property, or it can be income losses due to destruction of property, adverse liability judgments, medical costs to treat injuries, or what exactly you are doing now. You are, the benefit of this loss control, the risk control, you are trying to save something for the organization, right? If injury happens to an employee who is working, or if a death happens due to an accident which happens during his project, or if the company is incurring huge losses because of the financial transaction, what the finance manager will be doing. So instead of incurring those losses, the company should first try to train all its employees so that the loss can be minimized. Then there are various techniques of loss control. Now, before going to the techniques of loss control, we'll try to understand loss control process. So before knowing that the loss will happen, first we need to identify where the risk, the source of risk. See, you, a small example I want to give you is, you go to a doctor and without proper diagnosing, if he tells that you have a hole in your heart, so you need to go for a surgery. So immediately what happens to the patient? So the doctor will create a panic situation immediately, right? So a doctor is one who will diagnose the patient carefully and identify the risk involved in the coming days. So in the same way, how to control the loss? There are a lot of process involved in that. The first step is identification and analysis of losses. What I'm explaining now, the loss control process. The first step here is identification and analysis of losses. So students, the first step is to identify and analyze the losses that have occurred and the hazards that have caused them or might cause them in the future. So loss analysis involves detailed information gathering through a network of information and formal reports. Then the second process or the second step in loss control process is detailed analysis. So what happens in case of detailed analysis here, which is again the next step? The next step is to conduct a more detailed hazard analysis. The hazards to be investigated more thoroughly are revealed from preliminary loss analysis reports. They must also consider the possible factors that have not caused losses but can do so. So what we are studying now, I'm repeating once again, we're trying to study the loss control process. The first step is identification and analysis of losses. The second will be detailed analysis. And the third would be evaluation. So finally, evaluate the economic feasibility of loss control measure. There are three types of such costs which need to be added. One is direct costs that are obvious, indirect costs which are associated with accidents, and incidental or hidden costs. So what you're going to evaluate over there, that's very important, right? So finally, evaluate the economic feasibility of loss control measures. So although loss control is desirable, it may not always be possible or economically feasible. So installation of loss control has its costs and the potential gains. Its yields must be weighted against these costs. So if the gains do not outweigh the costs, the firm is better off without such activity. So the risk manager thus needs to conduct a cost-benefit analysis. The benefits are ascertained by assessing the cause of accidents that might occur. So after thoroughly understanding the loss control process, wherein we have discussed about identification, analysis of losses, detailed analysis and evaluation, we'll try to understand the techniques of loss control. So this will be the last topic for the day. So we will try to understand each technique in detail and then I will end the class. So what are the different techniques of loss control? We have already discussed in unit one, risk avoidance, loss prevention, loss reduction. Then we have separation, duplication and diversification. So we'll try to take each one of the technique and try to understand what exactly we need to do over there. See, loss or risk control is a conscious act or decision which are not to act that reduces the frequency or the severity of the losses or make losses more predictable. So there are various techniques of loss control. The first and the foremost, given we have discussed the same thing in unit one, that is risk avoidance. Students, the most effective way of managing any loss exposure is to avoid the exposure completely. That is very simple. You know, today, if you go out, the police will beat you because of the lockdown situation which has happened in the city. But you know that there is a risk that the police will beat you. In spite of that, you take and you go out without any work. So obviously, you will be getting the beating from the police, right? Instead of that, avoid that. So what happens if a loss exposure has successfully been avoided? Then the probability of a loss from that loss exposure is zero. Correct? So avoidance is what is a risk control technique that involves ceasing or never undertaking an activity so that the possibility of a future loss occurring from that activity is completely eliminated. I told you, right? Zero. So avoidance should be considered when the expected value of the losses from an activity outweighs the expected benefits of that activity. That is risk avoidance. Then the second technique is loss prevention. So it is a risk control technique that reduces the frequency of a particular loss. For example, you are storing inventory in a warehouse, which means that it is susceptible to be theft. However, since there really is no way to avoid it, a loss prevention program is put in place to minimize the loss. How? You can either put CCTVs over there, you can put two guards over there, or you can put alarms over there. If anybody enters that particular room, immediately an alarm should happen. So by doing that, you are preventing the loss, right? That is your loss prevention program. And the third one is loss reduction. Loss reduction is a technique that not only accepts the risk, but accepts the fact that loss might occur as a result of the risk. So this technique will seek to minimize the loss in the event of some type of threat. For example, a company might need to store flammable material in a warehouse, but a company management realizes that this is a necessary risk and decides to install state-of-the-art water sprinklers in the warehouse. So what happens if the fire occurs? The amount of loss will be, obviously, what happens, students? It will be minimized. Then we have separation, the fourth technique. So separation is a risk control technique that involves dispersing key assets. So an example of this, when a company utilizes a geographically diversified workforce, so this ensures that if something catastrophic occurs at one location, the impact to the business is limited to the assets only at that location. On the other hand, if all assets were at that location, then the business would face a much more serious challenge. Right? Then the fifth technique of loss control is duplication. It's very tricky, no? So duplication means what? It is a risk control technique that essentially involves the creation of a backup plan. I'm trying to duplicate. I'm trying to have a backup. So this is often necessary with the technology. So a failure with an information system server shouldn't bring the whole business to halt. Instead, what normally companies will do, a backup or a failover server should be readily available for access in the event that primary server fails. Correct, students? And last but not the least, diversification. So diversification means what? It is a risk control technique that allocates business resources to create multiple lines of business. So with diversification, a significant revenue loss from one line of business will not cause irreparable harm to the company's bottom line. So diversification is very, very important in almost all the business. That is very, very important. So what is diversification? If a company has started a business only in one sector, if that particular sector is not favorable due to government norms or due to weather conditions or due to the supply and demand factors, then automatically if the company has opened or started one more business parallelly, then immediately they can shift from that business to another business, or at least they'll be getting revenue from other business, right? So always we tell in the equity market also, your portfolio should never be a sectoral, sector specific stocks. Suppose if you have only IT sector stocks in your portfolio, or suppose if you have only pharma sector stocks in your portfolio, without diversification, if the pharma sector is not doing good, then entire pharma stocks will come down, right? So instead of that, what you can do is you can diversify in your portfolio. You can select the best good companies working in almost five different sectors and you can divide your amount and invest equally among all these stocks. So if pharma is not doing good, you have other four sector stocks in your portfolio. Correct? So that is called as diversification. So diversification majorly helps to minimize the losses associated with any type of business or investments. Okay, students. So in by this concept, I will end today's session. Thank you so much for your patience listening. I hope all of you are understanding are with me. Ranjit, are you there? Good afternoon, Ranjit.
Yes, sir. Good afternoon, sir.
Okay. How about the project work? How it is going on?
Sir, it's completed, sir. Just waiting for the sir's response.
Okay, okay. You have mailed already the draft copy?
Yes, sir. I had mailed it.
Okay. In fact, a couple of students have sent to me also. So probably by today evening, I will be sending the reports. Okay, students, thank you so much for your patience listening. Bye-bye and take care.
Thank you, sir. Have a good day.
Thank you, sir.